Today we'll calculate the atomic orbitals by casting the stationary states of a hydrogenic atom we obtained in the previous video into the position representation. The atomic orbitals we'll calculate today are not only important for experiments with hydrogen atom or one electron ion, but also important as a building block for many electron atoms, and provides a basis to understand the structure of the periodic table. We begin by writing the stationary states as a direct product of NL and LM. By casting into the position representation in spherical coordinates gives us the product of inner products bra r ket NL, bra theta phi ket LM. These inner products are in fact functions of the left argument of the bracket, which I'll name the bra r ket NL radial wave function, and denoted with symbol RNL, which I'll name the bra theta phi ket LM spherical harmonics, and denoted with symbol YLM. Beware that these superscripts do not mean exponent, but labels the wave function. We shall begin with the radial wave function. To work out the radial wave functions, we'll first write down the state that's being annihilated by the circularization operator CL, then casting the equation into the position representation by left multiplication with bra r. The radial momentum operator in position representation is displayed on the screen. Turns out this is a linear first order ODE. We can solve it by separation of variables. I'll leave it to you to verify the solution. The solution is this decaying exponential multiplied by r to some integer power, where n is a normalizing constant of no interest to us. Inspecting the exponential part of the function, we see that the function decays faster with increasing z, and it decays slower with increasing n. This is physically plausible, as electron becomes more tightly bound to the nucleus if the nuclear charge increases. Energy of the electron increases as n increases, therefore it can go further from a given nucleus. I have plotted the first four radial wave functions and displayed them on the screen. As you can see, the peak of the curves shifts to larger values of r as n increases, agreeing with our physical intuition. For chemists among you, you may recognize these as the radial parts of 1s, 2p, 3d, and 4f orbitals. Understanding the property and reactivity of first row transition metals starts with the understanding of the behavior of 3d orbitals, and the behavior of 4f orbitals underpins lanthanide chemistry. An interesting point to note is that ground state wave function of hydrogen has 13 over e to the power of 4, or roughly 23.8% chance of being in the classical forbidden region, with r greater than 2a0, where it classically would have negative kinetic energy. The phenomenon of being in a classical forbidden region is known as quantum tunneling. Almost a quarter chance of quantum tunneling shows hydrogen atom is a totally non-classical object and should not be treated like one. In the previous video, we called the state with L equals to m-1 the circular orbit, as these states have maximum amount of orbital angular momentum for a given energy. We now wish to find the radial wave functions of L equals to m-2. For the chemists among you, these are 2s, 3p, and 4d orbitals. By using the ladder operator CL-2 dagger we established in the previous video on these circular orbits, we arrived at L equals to m-2 radial wave function. Beware that the ladder operator is now labeled by the target state. We begin by working out the CL dagger in position representation, which is simply obtained by substituting radial momentum in position representation. We then use this operator on L equals to -1 eigenfunctions to obtain the L equals to -2 eigenfunctions. This procedure can be generalized to obtain states with less and less orbital angular momentum by resetting L to the target state until L equals to 0, which are the s orbitals for different principal quantum number. A key thing to note here is because of the ladder operator contains the first order differential operator in R, it always creates a term with R to the power of 1 less than the state with 1 more unit of orbital angular momentum, thus increasing the number of radial node by 1. This is physically plausible, as the radial kinetic energy operator has a term that is second order differential operator in R, hence greater curvature of the wave function, is associated with greater kinetic energy. Hence, a state with more radial kinetic energy has more curvature with respect to R, agreeing with the result we obtained by working through the algebra. Another important thing is that all of these radial wave functions are real functions, as L equals to n minus 1 radial wave functions are real functions, and the ladder operator is a real operator. In the video of probability current, I talked about the direction of flow of probability is given by the gradient of the complex phase. A real function means there isn't any probability current in the radial direction of the hydrogen atom, which means the electron is as likely to be moving out as in. I have now displayed all the radial wave functions from principal quantum number 1 to 3 on the screen. This concludes our discussion of the radial part of the atomic orbital. We now begin our discussion of angular dependence of the atomic orbital. To see what these mutual eigenstates of L squared and LZ look like in physical space, we wish to obtain the position representation of these states. From now on, we set h bar to 1 to simplify the algebra. Recalling the definition of orbital angular momentum and using the chain rule, we get the LZ operator is simply the differential operator in azimuthal angle phi multiplied by a factor of minus I to ensure it is Hermitian. The eigenvalue equation in LZ cannot be written as a linear first-order ODE. The solution is almost trivial. You can check this by differentiating with respect to phi. We have now found the phi dependence of the eigenfunction. Let's now work out the theta dependence. We first write down the equation of the highest weight state being annihilated by the raising operator L+. Then attempt to write the raising and the lowering operators in position representation. The algebra from here is extremely tiresome, so I will just display the results on the screen. You can verify these results by using chain rule to rewrite these operators in Cartesian coordinates. Again, we can convert the eigenvalue equation to a linear first-order ODE. Recognizing that the exponential cannot vanish, we can immediately ignore the phi dependence of the ODE. Recognizing the integral of cot theta is log sine theta, the ODE is solved simply by separation of variables. Hence, the polar angle dependence is given by sine to the L theta. We now have the spherical harmonics of the highest weight state up to a constant factor of normalization. To obtain the spherical harmonics with less projection of angular momentum onto the z-axis, we use the L- operator in position representation. Working through the algebra, we get the spherical harmonics with m equals to L-1 has one less unit of phi dependence in the exponential and one less unit of sine theta dependence and one more unit of cos theta dependence. The result of subtracting m by 1 and subtracting the exponent of sine theta by 1 and increasing the exponent of cos theta by 1 every time after using the lowering operator is completely general. This is physically plausible. The state with maximum amount of projection of orbital angular momentum onto the z-axis classically corresponds to an equatorial orbit. In the language of quantum mechanics, it translates to we are most likely to find the particle close to the equatorial plane. This is demonstrated by the mathematical form of the spherical harmonics YLL, where sine theta is raised to a maximum integer power. As theta equals to pi over 2 at the equatorial plane, the wave function rapidly diminishes as theta deviates from pi by 2. However, when the power of cos theta increases, as we use L- operator, we are more and more likely to find the particle in the polar caps, where theta equals to 0 for north pole, theta equals to pi for south pole. Classically, this is entirely analogous to tilting the orbital plane such that an equatorial orbit gradually becomes a polar orbit. However, beware that a well-defined inclination of orbital plane does not exist in quantum mechanics, as the inability of Lz to commute with either Lx and Ly forbids us to know how much angular momentum there is in the x and y axis. In addition, a well-defined orbital plane is a two-dimensional object with very sharp edge in three-dimensional space. Knowing that sharp edges are associated with arbitrarily high curvature around the edge and orbital angular momentum in quantum mechanics is associated with the rate of change of the wave function with respect to angle theta and phi, a typical system at the atomic scale does not have enough orbital angular momentum to form a sharp-edged orbital plane. This is the exact reason that atomic orbitals are lobes rather than orbital planes. The square modulus of the spherical harmonics is independent of phi. However, if we wish to localize the particle in x or y direction, we need to take a linear combination of spherical harmonics, such that the quantum interference between them give rise to certainty in the azimuthal angle of the particle on the sphere. Our increasing certainty in the x and y direction is compensated by our loss of certainty in the z direction. This is a very common and fundamental feature of quantum mechanics, and you have seen this numerous times in other videos on this channel. Go check out the other videos if you haven't. This is also how the atomic orbitals typically used in chemistry are constructed. I have displayed the first 16 spherical harmonics on the screen. This corresponds to the s and the 3 of the p orbitals filled by the main group elements, 5 of the d orbitals filled by transition metals, and 7 of the f orbitals filled by lanthanides and actinides on the periodic table. To recover classical intuition from these rather strangely shaped spherical harmonics, imagine the classical trajectory of electron is always normal to the nodal plane. The nodal planes are imaginary planes that separate the lobes of different phase. Group of lobes lying down then gradually standing up as the absolute value of m decreases correspond to the classical picture of increasing the inclination of orbital plane to the equatorial plane, such that it eventually becomes a polar orbit. This concludes our discussion of the angular part of the atomic orbital and our discussion of the structure of hydrogen. We'll use these results extensively in our future discussion of atomic structure. The next element on the periodic table is helium. However, we cannot immediately understand the structure of helium. This is because due to the electron-electron repulsion, the Schrödinger equation no longer can be solved analytically. We need to resort to various approximation methods. In addition, we neglected the spin of the electron in our treatment of the hydrogen atom. Spin can no longer be neglected in helium, as there are two electrons in the helium atom, and the interplay between the spin states of the two electrons give rise to far-reaching consequences on the structure of helium. So our plan in the next few videos is to start by examining spin in more detail by considering the coupling of angular momentum. We'll then attempt to understand the nature of quantum entanglement arising from the coupling of spin states. Finally, we'll establish some powerful approximation methods that allows us to approximate the solutions of the Schrödinger equation when it is not possible to be solved analytically. Thank you for watching, and stay tuned for the next video, angular momentum coupling.